All right, we will get started. I'm Tom Gross with the Historic Preservation Section, and I'd like to welcome you all to this morning's speaker series event. This is an event that we try to put on every other month. And this morning we are pleased to have Aaron Marcavitch as our speaker. Aaron is the Executive Director of Maryland Milestones Anacostia Trails Heritage Area Incorporated, a heritage tourism organization based in Hyattsville. A resident of Greenbelt, Aaron has degrees in public history and historic preservation and has worked in the fields of community development, heritage, and historic preservation for over 15 years. And I'd say I think we both have the distinction of being former students of our colleague, Fred Statura.
Yep.
Myself at the University of Maryland and you're up at Roger Williams.
The very first year he started teaching.
So there you go. All roads lead to wherever Fred goes, people
That's right,
up.
Then we just follow
Aaron is the past chair of the county's War of 1812 Commission and past chair of the Capitol Trails Coalition. And in July of this year, Aaron was sworn in as a member of the county's Historic Preservation Commission. We're gratified to have his experience and perspective brought to bear on the HPC's oversight of the county's historic resources. And we are excited to hear from him today on the topics of heritage areas and his recently published book on the history of Route 1 from Baltimore to Washington. So with that, I will turn it over to Aaron.
All right. And you've got thank you very much, Tom. I got this. Yep. So good morning, everybody. Thank you for coming out. I will move around a little bit because I tend to want to point at pictures as we go. So we'll be doing a lot of pointing. So I've mushed together two different presentations. I shortened up the Route 1 program. If you want to hear the full hour and about 15-minute program, you'll have to find me at one of those lectures. But we'll get the most of the taste of it. And then the other part is more of the on the planning side of who the heck is Anacostia Trails Heritage Area, who the heck is Maryland Milestones, and what is it that they do. Our organization is part of a larger program, and you may have heard of heritage areas in the state of Maryland. You may have heard of them in the in a broader scale. So I wanted to give you a taste of what that's all about. Before I talk about the Maryland ones in particular, heritage areas programs actually exist on the national level. I think there's 49 of them across the United States. And what they are is regions that have a cohesive theme to them, an interpretive theme. So the Delaware and Lehigh is an example, and they use trails, waterways, they use all sorts of different ways of kind of connecting their history. You tend to see them in industrial corridors, former industrial corridors. The river in Rhode Island that escapes my mind right now, up through Woonsocket and Providence is one of the oldest ones. They're in Ohio, they're in Arizona, they're all over the United States. And generally those national ones are based off of models that come out of England and Australia, actually. How do you do large landscape conservation without actually owning any of the property? How do you deal with that? We understand how a national park works. They own that property, they maintain it. We understand how Park and Rec maintains those kinds of landscapes. But whenever that landscape, if we take, for example, if we could roll back Prince George's County and we take something like Riversdale and the Calverts, well, they didn't exist just on that little tiny piece of property that is Riversdale. They existed over a very large section of land. So how do we knit all of those stories together? How do we make all those connections? So that's the idea behind heritage areas. And Pennsylvania got into the act largely through one of their former directors, Brenda Barrett, who said, we should take this national idea and shrink it down to a state level program. So Pennsylvania jumped out of the gate and they created a series of heritage areas across the state of Pennsylvania. Some of them are national, some of them are state level. And Maryland said, that's a really great idea. So in 1997, they passed a piece of legislation that created the Heritage Areas Program. And the first one that was created was Canal Place up in Cumberland. And that's the oldest one. It is actually really just the downtown of Cumberland. They're in the process of expanding that. And over the year, well, at that point, we had folks largely in Bladensburg come along and say, hey, we want some of that money. So they were trying to get into that program, and that was whenever Anacostia Trails was created. We were sort of in the third wave of heritage areas, right after Canal Place happened. We had a couple out on the Eastern Shore that got started, Lower Susquehanna, and then we grew out just after that period of time. And the idea was largely based originally around the Bladensburg area, and it sort of expanded as more and more people got involved. Originally, after Bladensburg, it became, well, let's just stay inside the Beltway. After it did that, then people said, well, we need Laurel involved. They needed some political support. And so we grew all the way up to there. I'll show you, this is not quite an updated map because it doesn't include Bowie yet, and it actually shows Patapsco as a recognized. There's a two-stage process that heritage areas go through. They first are recognized and then they are certified. But at this point, the state is really not interested in having another heritage area. And I'll talk more about that in a few moments as well. But you can see there are 13 heritage areas stretching from Garrett County all the way over to Ocean City. So some of them are your node and line type of layout. Some of them are larger squares of place. So I'm not going to read all of this to you, but it gives you a sense of, you know, what it is that we're all about. The stories of the people, individuals, businesses, nonprofits, forming partnerships. Partnerships is at the core of what we do. And then the links to the place and past and how we work with each other. How do we tell those stories? So that gives you an idea of what heritage areas are all about. More of this stuff is on the heritage areas website, not just ours, but pretty much all of them. So we are operated through the Maryland Heritage Areas Authority. It is a representative group of state agencies. So MDOT is there. We live under Maryland Department of Planning. I am not a state employee, though. We are a management entity, which is a nonprofit. I think all but all but three of us are nonprofits. One is Canal Place, which is a state agency, and two are county agencies through their Conference and Visitors Bureau. We have a really strong connection with the tourism world. That's one of our main keys is heritage tourism. I, again, come from a background of public history and historic preservation, so I'm one of the few people that has a historic preservation type of angle. I then worked in affordable housing on the island of Nantucket in Massachusetts, which Nantucket and affordable housing is a bit of an oxymoron. If you know the area, but I did work there and was very involved. I sat on the planning board there. I worked with the HDC there. So I've been involved in all those kinds of things. When I came here, this was a transition into some nonprofit historic preservation work. And we're going to talk a little bit about the targeted financial and technical assistance in a few moments. All right, I got to make sure I point to this thing. Okay, so Anacostia Trails Heritage Area, we were certified in 2001, covering northern Prince George's County. You can see our interpretive themes are transportation and communication, which is how we get to the US 1 book. And that is also that brochure that I left over there, the red one, which is the Linking the Nation tour. And I'll talk more about those in just a minute. Agriculture, community development, Route 1, et cetera, but also centered around the trail system. Whenever we were first established, they were struggling around to try to find a name for the organization. And they said, well, Anacostia, because they started in Bladensburg, remember, that we should be the, and they were, you know, the Anacostia Transportation Heritage Area. Now that doesn't work, that's not catchy. They came up with Anacostia Trailways Heritage Area. And then they got a letter in the mail from the Trailways bus company saying, no, you can't use that name. So that's how we ended up with Anacostia Trails Heritage Area. But one of the first things that happened whenever I came in the door was I said, well, everybody thinks that we're working in DC on that part of Anacostia, and we're not. And everybody thinks that we own the trails, and we don't. We're getting calls from people who say, please pick up these tree limbs that have fallen on the trails. We've got to fix that problem. That's how we got to the Maryland Milestones branding. We'll talk about that in just a few minutes. So we reformatted the organization in 2009. When we were first established, we actually lived under the Redevelopment Authority for a little bit. And we had a governing board that was made up of folks from all of our communities. So the mayors and the council people. Well, mayors and councils and that sort of thing are wonderful people whenever they want to talk about how they can try to work together. But what tends to happen is they sit at the table and they come up with really great ideas, and then they walk out the door and go deal with their pothole situation that they've got. They don't have the ability to spend a lot of time focusing on these broad network issues. So whenever we reformatted in 2009, we actually created a managing board that has just representatives from any old place. We wanted to make sure that it was a working board, that they were going to work like a nonprofit. And we still keep that group of municipal leaders as our governing board, sort of our board of advisors in some ways. And so, you know, folks like Joe come and support us there, and Ivy actually supports us on the managing board side. So we have that kind of connection. I came in 2010. In 2013, we redid our branding. In 2000, was it 16 or 15? Actually, after I typed it, I said I couldn't remember if it was 15 or 16. We expanded to Bowie, Chevrolet, and portions of the Glendale area. And that the reason that we expanded to those places first is because their stories were the most similar to the stories we were already telling. Community growth, transportation. I was really looking for Bowie in a lot of ways because it had a museum of agriculture, the Bowie Stables Museum, and it also had a railroad museum. And I said, those pieces make a lot of sense for our story. We need to make sure that we can point at those things. 17 total communities, a budget of $200,000, $250,000, so we're pretty small. The entire staff is here with you today. We're hoping to change that within about a month and bring on a half-time person. And that's pretty typical for most of the heritage areas. They're usually a person and a half, sometimes two people. We're generally pretty small operations, pretty lean and mean. We get $100,000 from the state of Maryland to support us. And we then get we then have to match that $100,000 with funds from other places. We actually get a legislative set aside from the county council, and all the towns also pay into our program based on population. So those funds are what supports us. We then also do a small amount of fundraising. We also get grants, and I'll talk about those in another moment. Key thing to know is that we focus on history, art, culture, and nature. So there's our area that you can see. Oh, I gotta remember I'm still on camera. You can see Route 1 running up through this area here. We've got 495, 95. Here's 295, the BW Parkway. And originally our boundary had been the BW Parkway with sort of a lump that included the Patuxent Wildlife Refuge. So we've now taken in portion of Chevrolet, a portion of Glendale that largely includes the Glendale Hospital, and then this portion of Bowie, largely centered on the Patuxent River, although it includes sort of the old original Levittown portion as well. And we ended up bringing it down to here because of a couple of parks, but also the Radio and Television Museum. So that's how we ended up with those boundaries. We're now starting to have conversations that we haven't had as much attention paid to sort of this side of things. There is a heritage area in Montgomery County, but now we're having some conversations with a new community development corporation, the Northern Gateway CDC, which is working in the Langley Park area. But you can also see then the trail network running through there, historic Greenbelt here. And a funny story about Laurel is that they were really instrumental in getting us moved through the system. The approval of this process requires an amendment to the master plan, which is why we worked with park and planning quite a bit. But Laurel was needed for a little bit of political pressure in a bigger way. But because they have their own zoning authority, they didn't pass it correctly, and Laurel was not part of our area for a very long time. Finally went back to him and said, you guys are missing out on money, you need to get back in the area. So now we're involved with them, and we're learning sort of their process and how they work. It's a whole new world for me up there. I understand the park and planning system. Laurel's is a little bit different. So again, what do? Grants and assistance. We have two grant programs. We have the major grant program, which I have the flyer over here. Generally, if it's a capital project, it's up to $100,000. If it's a non-capital project, it's up to $50,000. Those are to be used for tourism-related history, art, culture, and nature. You want to build an art center? Okay, come on in. If you have you want to restore a historic building, great, we can do that. If you have let's see, College Park Aviation Museum recently came in and got money for wayfinding. Bostwick House in Bladensburg came in for money. The Pyramid Atlantic Arts Center, where we're located, which I'll talk about more in a moment, got $90,000. So those are the kinds of projects that we see. But we also then see small projects, $10,000 to Anacostia Watershed Society to redo their river field guide. So a whole variety of things. Our rocket grants, we recently rebranded our mini grants. Our rocket grants are used for almost anything, again, that's related to the heritage area. Generally, they're up to $5,000, and they're intended to be seed grants. And it could be another hour of me explaining that. What I will tell you is that in January, we'll be having grant workshops. If you're interested in those, or you know people within your communities that you might be working with that would like to find out more about those, come for those grant workshops in January. Check our website for those. I also work with communities on designing, developing signage, brochures. We had a great meeting with Bowie talking about their heritage trail program. So we work with that kind of thing, doing that kind of assistance. Community leadership, advocacy, partnerships. I meet, that's what my life is just meetings, just going to meetings and meeting with people. I think you all understand that probably better than any group I could talk to about constantly going to meetings. And that's my job, is just to keep my finger on the pulse of everything that's going on, working with Prince George's Heritage, for example, all the way to working with the Arts District, to working with Anacostia Watershed, for examples. Marketing support, you may have seen some of that. You may be signed up on our e-blast. You may be on our Facebook page, our Twitter. We do a lot of that kind of marketing. Right now, we are in the holidays in the heritage area. So there are there's at least 100 different, Alex, you can move that stuff. That's just me. Yeah, go ahead. There's a whole variety of things that are going on related to the holidays, and so we try to help promote those. You can see a couple of examples. We've been very involved with bike infrastructure in the region, and the reason that we're involved with that is because we see the trails as a big tourism benefit. How those pieces are used as bike tourism. So this is a group that was being talked to about advocacy related to the extension of the trolley trail in Hyattsville. This is a bike infrastructure work group that we had, and this was the launch of M-Bike in College Park. Some of our successes you can see here, War of 1812 commemoration. I don't know if you came out for that, but that was a very big program. I'm going to talk about the Heritage Center in just a moment, our bike ped, capital trails, etc. We also have a group that's called the History Consortium, which is made up of members of all the museums in the county, and we're trying to move some of those museums along. And then a couple of our recent grants, the Civil Rights Trail is still a don't tell too many people yet. We're going to be trying to launch that in the next couple of months. And the Civil Rights Trail is going to be a large website plus also signage around the county that are all related to mostly African-American civil rights in Prince George's County because of the grant funding we've got, but we also have some funding that will allow us to tell other stories, Latino stories, women's rights, such as the suffragette trail, a suffragette location in Hyattsville, etc. So we're going to be getting into that. And then the Battle of Bladensburg Trust is a group that we're trying to pull together. After we were done with the commemoration of the Battle of Bladensburg, everything kind of got left behind. We were so tired and worn out from it that we didn't really continue on with that. So the Battle of Bladensburg Trust is the attempt to come back on a few of those programs that we need to finish up there. And of course, we've been become more sustainable in our funding. So very quickly through our Heritage Center, this building started its life as a church. If you have not been inside the Pyramid Atlantic Arts Center, come on December 12th. It's our holiday party. It's a chance to check it out inside. You're all welcome to come to that. And so back kind of where this setback wall is a piece of church wall, the remains of the church. And then after the church was bought in 1915, so, you know, Hyattsville is only really, what, 1887, I think? So it really was only from 87 to 1915 that it existed like that. It was bought up by a guy who turned it into a movie theater, a silent movie theater, and there's pieces of that that remain. Downstairs was a bowling alley, a barber shop, and a ice cream parlor. And this was the entrance. This kind of large doorway here was the entrance into the theater. It's been converted. It had many iterations in the time that I've been here about what it was going to become, but it most recently has landed as Pyramid Atlantic Arts Center. And if you've ever, if you remember industrial arts class from whenever you were in school, it's like a big industrial arts place inside. All kinds of screen printing, giant cutters and paper making devices. It's really kind of a neat place to walk through. Upstairs is a gallery as well as artist studio. So it's kind of a mixed use type of thing, although very centered on arts. Right across the street is Vigilante Coffee. So you can come have your coffee and then go do some art stuff or go to Franklin's and some of the other Ale Trail related places in the area. You're going to be seeing that name more later. So our center is right now only about a third done. We're going to be about 95% done in about 2 weeks. So I'm crossing all my fingers that all the exhibits land in the right time. So they're supposed to come on the 10th because our opening is on the 12th. So inside, you have to imagine this is the spread out. This is the three walls. This is the back wall, the left wall, and the right wall. The right wall has an art segment to it, as well as our brochure rack. We took the original plans for the arts district, and the original design for the art district was a hand-drawn type of map that planning did, I don't know how many years ago, so we had to scan it in. It took forever to find the original design. On the back is an image that you'll see later in the presentation, and what will happen is that this exhibit panel will open up, and inside is a 55-inch television that we can do workshop presentations, lectures, and that sort of thing. What's missing in this particular design is this upper part of the wall will be several artifacts that have been loaned to me from communities, signs, we have a 1930s bicycle, that sort of stuff. So this was done with $50,000 from a bond bill. We raised an additional $15,000, matched it with other costs. Build out, you see some of those items there. Neighborhood Design Center, if you've worked with Neighborhood Design Center, is located within this building as well. And they've been great to work with. Make sure you turn off your phones. So these are a couple of our examples of partner events. I won't go through all of these, but you can see just kind of the whole range of things. Arts and Ales, meetings with groups about new facilities, attending conferences and presentations. I just got back from San Francisco and the National Trust. So a whole range of places. Looking ahead, Upper Marlboro has contacted us and said that they really want to be part of the heritage area. So we're working on trying to figure out how do we expand to the rest of the county. The folks in the Potomac area would like to have us expand as well. Places like Fairmont Heights are places that we need to figure out how all these pieces connect. So we're looking at trying to find funding to do that study. Between $20,000 and $50,000 to do that. We continue to do a lot of these other things. Again, grant funds, they open in January, so get ready for that. And again, our completion of our Heritage Center, so December 12th, 6 p.m., feel free to come by and join us. Okay, enough of that stuff. Let's get on to Route 1. I always like to make sure that I do that because that way I'm sure that I'm getting paid by my work to do that. All right, US 1, who has been to the Fort Kent, Maine end of Route 1? Anybody? How about the Key West end? All right, I always get at least a few hands on Key West end. All the way to the end, Florida. Yeah, down to that end. There's the Fort Kent, Maine end, which is a very different kind of place than the Key West end. There's actually about three, maybe four different types of roads whenever we talk about US 1. You've got the northern part, which is actually an old post road. So it's intentionally going through many little communities because it's delivering the mail all the way through from New York, Connecticut, Massachusetts, all the way up. Now, that was where I studied whenever I was in my undergraduate. So I know sort of that experience. I have been all the way to Fort Kent, Maine. It is very desolate up there. But that is that northern stretch. There is a stretch that is largely from Richmond to sort of Savannah area, and that is a sort of southern plantation type of road. So it's a little bit more meandering, it's a little bit more just connecting large plantations. There is a section that's in Key West in Florida, that's a whole different kind of road. that's maybe our section 3A or section 4, if you will. But section 2 here in the middle is this mid-Atlantic section, generally from New York to Richmond. And that road is what we're going to be talking about. It is a very much a travel road, a stagecoach road. It's largely 66 feet wide because of the old chain rod method of measuring. So it's all very much planned out. So it's a very different type of road than it is in different ways. You could probably say the section through New Jersey is similar to us in some ways, but the New Jersey section actually has a lot more roadside architecture. So whenever I did my master's degree in Tennessee, my thesis was on roadside architecture, the development of standardized architecture. Why do McDonald's look like McDonald's all over the world, and why does that make us feel better about ourselves, kind of thing. So I started out studying amusement parks, and then I did a short stint in barbecue stands and ice cream stands, and then went to just plain roadside architecture. So that's sort of been my thing, although I'm starting to do a hard left turn into some climate change stuff. But so this is a sign from Florida showing we're headed towards Fort Kent. We're going to stick with this middle section. This is why I did the book, The Little Tavern. Anybody ever buy them by the bag? Yeah, okay. So these were a small DC based chain. It actually started in Kentucky originally, but then immediately after starting it came and moved to the DC area. There were several of them around. This one is in downtown College Park, was torn down by the university, I guess because it reminded folks of burning couches or something to that effect. And so that's now gone. The thing that really just drives me insane is that they call it Little Tavern Park. There's no signs that say that. There's no reference to it. It's just sort of a leftover name. And so they say, well, come to Little Tavern Park and enjoy our music. But there's no Little Tavern reference. So it just drives me nuts. So this was why I started doing this, is that I realized in our management plan, there was a call out for something like this, a history of some type. But we also have so many new people moving into US Route 1. HDC, we've been reviewing these projects on US Route 1 where we're gonna have hundreds of new people coming in very soon. Well, their relationship to the community, I mean, sometimes it changes every 4 to 8 years, right? The populations just are constantly changing. And folks on US 1 maybe move in and just go, ugh, it's just gross. It's just power lines and roadside. Well, that's what it's been. That's what it is. So I wanted people to have a better understanding of that. I used the Arcadia system, which is 180 to 200 pictures. I started out with 10 and went, don't know what to do, but I found a great collection in the Bureau of Public Roads at the National Archives, and really that filled out a huge amount of this book. If you have not used the Bureau of Public Roads book, you've got to remember, the only way in and out of DC was US 1 for a very long time. So when they needed a picture of something on a road, that's where they went. They went out on US 1. So Virginia and Maryland are pretty well documented by this Bureau of Public Roads. You can see some of the other ones there as well. So starting 300 years ago, we're going to move really fast for about the first 200 years. We're gonna really snap through these things. Starting about 300 years ago, this lower image is an image that was done by State Highways Administration. Whenever they were doing the War of 1812, what this shows is a building called the Market Master. The Market Master was essentially at the end of the wharves in Bladensburg, and that's where all the news and trade happened, right out of that building. If you can imagine back where those sails are, those sails represent about the location of Peace Cross. So that gives you a sense of where you are. There, you're missing the big bridges that carry the railroad and Kenilworth Avenue across. And of course, US 1 at this time was a rolling road. We may have heard the term rolling road in other examples, but this was a rolling road. You would roll these hogshead of tobacco down from the plantations, generally through enslaved labor, down to the ships at the water. And there were two major ends in this particular portion. There was the Elk Ridge Landing end, and there was the Bladensburg end. And Bladensburg was a tobacco weighing port. Elk Ridge was a tobacco weighing port. The middle section was a little bit weaker, but here's a drawing that was done in the 30s, a map done in the 30s, that is supposed to represent 1794. So here you've got Bladensburg, you've got Riversdale, Vanville, Montpelier, which is not really Laurel, Birmingham Manor, Colonel Griffith is Savage, St. John's, and there's Elkridge Landing. And Elkridge Landing had had a ferry for the very first parts of its life before it was replaced by a wooden bridge. Bladensburg actually did not have the bridge that we know today near Peace Cross. You had to cross up closer to Hyattsville. And then the road came in around Mount Clair into Baltimore. Mount Clair is approximately where the B&O Railroad Museum is-ish. And then the other road that you can see here is this road, and that is roughly US 29. Now, the reason I like to point those out is because that bookends two ends with something very significant. And the reason why we have Route 1 where it is because in between there is the fall line. The fall line is the point where the land moves from the Piedmont into the coastal plain, and the land turns from rocky to a sandy coastal plain. If you go up on 29, there's a Trader Joe's, and in behind there, if you kind of walk back in the trails, it's very rocky, big boulders. Well, that's the fall line. Great Falls is another point where the fall line occurs, right across here. So that fall line, we have US 1 on the coastal plain side and US 29 on that upland Piedmont side. So that's why we have US 1 where we have it, is because that whenever they started to stitch together the road to create US 1 in the 1910s and 20s, they were looking at ones that would follow that fall line route. A few examples, a few bits from, again, that early history. This is an image that was taken by Rochambeau's wagon train. If you've listened to Hamilton recently, you'll have heard Rochambeau as they were headed towards Yorktown. And that wagon train that was under Lafayette and Hamilton and all those guys included Rochambeau. And he went out, Rochambeau went through Annapolis, but his wagon train actually came through what is labeled as Blandensburg by the French. But this actually shows where they were put their camps up. And those camps are basically in modern Hyattsville. Again, that bridge doesn't exist yet coming across there. In 1812, okay, we're getting into that kind of period. In 1812, there was a turnpike created, largely under the Calvert family, and that turnpike ran all the way on this section of Route 1. There's only one piece of the turnpike history left, and that is this stone that is located right near the IKEA in College Park. If you pull into the IKEA, there's a Japanese store, a Japanese restaurant, and it's kind of right out in front of that. It's sort of a decent interpretive place. It could use a little bit more help, but that's the only piece that's remaining. This is just an example. This is from the Patapsco River, but you can kind of get a feel for what that road would have looked like at the time. It's a trail cut through the woods. I have been asked, and I have actually talked with Jen Stabler before about this, is there a way that we know that this was a Native American trail? Not really. But then again, people don't necessarily just form a road just randomly cut through the woods. It happens, but there seems to be at least some sort of reasoning why perhaps it was there. But, you know, there's no solid evidence. There's nothing that would tell us that that was. You know, that we had a conversation just like the Ravens Redskins line exists right around Laurel. That same history has always existed. The northern part was the Susquehannock, and the southern part was the Anacostian. And they were very different types of populations, and it sort of was right in that middle area where the two worlds would have collided. So having a road through there doesn't make a huge amount of sense, but we're not really sure. It was certainly a tobacco rolling road. That's why I start when I start, because anything prior to that is a little bit too much conjecture. Here's an image that was done by the National Park Service showing the Battle of Bladensburg. So the War of 1812 was in 1814. The War of 1812 started in 1812 in other parts of the world, but it was here in 1814. We just recently celebrated that 200th anniversary. What this shows is you would be on modern alternate US 1 Bladensburg Road. This is Fort Lincoln Cemetery off to this right side there. And this is off, this road sort of running along the edge is what remains now today as Bunker Hill Road, of which there's pieces in Mount Rainier and pieces in Cottage City. So this is all Cottage City, if you will, over here. And this is Bladensburg here. You can see what is Bostwick House. Of course, it didn't look like that at that time. But this is the Anacostia River kind of running through there. So it's a reconstruction. Gives you a fair sense of it. If you like, I can give you the full two-hour War of 1812 conversation as well. But I'd say come back next summer. We'll do a bike ride and talk about it. So now we're going to jump from 1814 to 1835. Like I said, we're going to move quickly through this. In 1835, the railroads arrive in the D.C. area. This is an image showing the train crossing the Tiber Creek. Now, this is not the Ellicott City Tiber Creek. This is the D.C. Tiber Creek. The D.C. Tiber Creek is largely underground now for the pieces that exist. Every now and again, a building in D.C. will suddenly get randomly flooded, and it's because the old Tiber Creek has come back and exacted its revenge. This is largely around Ivy City. Type of area. So off in the distance are the hills of Hyattsville and et cetera. This image showing a Civil War guard is at the Muirkirk Ironworks. This image is actually a scan of a scan, which I hated to do, but the original has seemingly gone missing somewhere. It was, I believe, actually within Park and Planning somewhere, and nobody can find it now. But this shows the Muirkirk Ironworks, which is, of course, where they discovered the Astrodon Johnsonidae, our state dinosaur, and is basically where the dinosaur park is located up near Laurel. So this is the Hyattsville Station. We're going to jump forward again. We've now just completely skipped over the Civil War, and we're going to move into the 1870s. This is a later image showing the Hyattsville Station that got torn down in the 1950s, which is just a fantastic building. Francis Baldwin, just a beautiful stick style with the Queen Anne types of elements all in brick. But what I really liked was this image. Now, this is an 1872 image that says Bladensburg Station. In 1872, the Baltimore and Ohio Railroad did what we would now know as an Instagram tour. So today we might call out some of our influencers and ask them to come and take pictures and put them on Instagram. Well, in 1872, the Baltimore and Ohio called around to photographers and artists and poets and said, please come ride our trains and then put these pictures out to the universe and tell people to come and ride the Baltimore and Ohio Railroad. And one of the things that was produced was a photo booklet that included this image. And I said, the problem is that Bladensburg never had a station like that. It never had something come through that was a main line. So I was very confused by it. What I found out after digging around was I found this picture from 1929. What this shows is the construction of the new section of Rhode Island Avenue, what we now know as modern US 1. This is 1929 that section was completed, right? And they've just cut it through. They're just putting in the ground. Off in the distance here, you can see the viaduct. Well, the first viaduct that went up and over the railroad into Bladensburg. But what I spotted in the background was the most important part. Back here, you can just barely make it out, is the Hyattsville Railroad Station. And in front of it is this building. Slightly modified, but it's that building. So that isn't the Bladensburg Station, but Hyattsville didn't exist till 1887. So in 1872, that was Bladensburg still. That was just the outskirts of Bladensburg. So that Bladensburg Station, this is US 1 passing behind it, what would become the alternate US 1. And this Bladensburg Station, that store, is still being used by the railroad. This is approximately across from the modern county admin buildings that are up in Hyattsville, where the police are. I got to make sure I get my book here. I got to make sure I read these quotes. So probably about 80% of these images are in the book. Not all of them are in there. You're getting some of the pictures that came in later, et cetera. So the upper image is an image of the Elkridge iron furnaces. So Elkridge, just like Muirkirk, had a deposit of iron, and they tended to work it. And it was... one of the main reasons why Elkridge managed to survive. I should mention that both Elkridge and Bladensburg sort of died off because of the silting in of the water. We know about the Anacostia. Many of us know about the Anacostia because it silts in largely from the stuff that's washed upstream, the plantations and stuff, and it silts in. Elkridge actually silts in for a different reason. It's actually silting in, silted in because of, and I shouldn't even say silted, it was actually raised up because of the ballast being tossed off of ships, sand and rocks, and that filled in the harbor, and they ended up leaving approximately the same time, about the 1830s, 1840s. They were both basically abandoned as deep water ports. But this image here is what really struck me and what got me. I love this picture of this building with telephones on the top. So in the background is the Thomas Viaduct. The Thomas Viaduct was the major route out of Baltimore. And this Thomas Viaduct is still in operation. It's one of or the oldest stone arch bridges in the world that's still in use. But this telephone thing is what caught me. So an 1884 advertisement for viaduct manufacturing reads, "Having increased facilities and ample capital, we will carry a large stock of telephone, telegraph, electric light. Our works on the Patapsco River at the relay station, B&O Railroad, with an abundance of water power. We carry continually a large stock of crossarms, pins, brackets, insulators, and wires." Then in 1890, it says, "The company makes everything from electrical, but its specialties are telephones, magneto bells, district messenger call boxes, and student telegraph outfits." I don't know what a student telegraph outfit is, but it sounds interesting. Portions of the factory were built on a former mill. And the reason that this is here is it's a company owned by A.G. Davis. A.G. Davis was a cousin of Samuel Morse, the guy that invented Morse code, who learned his trade in New York and Canada. So he came to Baltimore and built the factory. The office was in Baltimore. The reason that this is called relay is that's where the horses were relayed. When the railroad first started, it was being pulled by horses, got pulled to relay. The horses were changed out. They were relayed, and then it continued on to Ellicott City. Now it then turned there. Okay. Anybody know where this is? Any ideas?
A little hard to see.
It is.
George Washington.
It seems like the George Washington House. That's a good guess. Similar. What you're missing is a peaked roof over top of that arched window, which would make you know that that is the Rossborough Inn at the University of Maryland. Changed completely. This is about 1899. In the 1930s, it was colonial revival-fied. And all the pieces were taken off, the roof was taken off and redone. And if you look today, you'll see that brickwork is significantly changed up here on the top, at least. But some of the original portions are still underneath there. But that's the same structure. US 1 is here in front, running right in front of that fence. And then you can see the fields. Of course, University of Maryland, 1858, started as Maryland Agricultural College, went bankrupt several times. The thing that I really like, that really struck me was nobody got degrees for the first couple of years. I was really confused as to why this university would have started up and not handed out degrees. Well, then it occurred to me, it was operating essentially as an extension. You're a farmer, you don't need a degree. You're going to come, you're going to learn some tricks of the trade, and you're going to go back. You don't need a degree. So finally, after about 10, 15 years, they have their first degrees. They never quite get out of some of the bankruptcy that they go through. The state takes over. A massive fire occurs on the property, and the state comes into full ownership of the university. But it started its life as Maryland Agriculture College. This taverns was one of the things that the Calvert family of Riversdale dabbled in. So this was one of their taverns. They also owned the tavern at Waterloo, Spurrier's Tavern, Maryland 175 crosses Route 1. They owned that. It was called Waterloo originally. And then Lafayette came through, the same Lafayette from our Hamilton discussion. He came through. He was offended that it was called Waterloo as a French guy and refused to stay there and came down and stayed at Rossborough. And immediately Mrs. Calvert went up and changed the name to Spurrier's Tavern. So that's how the story of Waterloo goes. I love this image. This really shows 20th century coming together. This is, anybody know where we are here? College Park, exactly, 1909, just after it's opened by the Wright brothers. The B&O Railroad running here, approximately the location of the Green Line and the Mark trains. At this point, the airfield is angled, so it's parallel with the train line. Now it is perpendicular to it. There is still a a structure from the airmail era on the property over there, kind of in this location. It was, again, one of those places that was a public-private partnership before public-private partnerships were a thing. Rex Smith, a private business, was on the property, as well as the Army Aviation Unit. And it is a field of firsts. Most of you should know it, and I think everybody has the line memorized, the oldest continuously operating airfield in the world. So that's College Park. This image is Laurel, 1902, showing all of the people in their finest. They are these are the wives of the council members about to board the trolley and head south back to the Treasury. The trolley line went all the way to Laurel in 1902, but was continually cut back over time. So it didn't last up to Laurel. There is still a stretch through, I can't remember the name of the cemetery, but there's a cemetery up there. There's still a stretch where you can kind of see it still. This is a fantastic image, this lower one. That's from 1900. And I always like to make sure I get the information right. If you ever have an extra minute to go do some research, I would encourage you to do it. Train of the Future reads the headline on July 10th, 1900. Frederick Adams had, he came from Chicago. He asked the Baltimore and Ohio Railroad if he could test a theory that he had with his, this is called the wind splitter. Instead of being a series of connected boxes on wheels, it will have graceful and continuous lines. So he reached up to 90 miles an hour with this test in 1900. So this is just streamlining. But streamlining didn't really happen for another 20, 30 years. So, of course, he goes home, is broke, penniless, all that sort of stuff that inventors do. And but is just another great example. He's covered this entire train and is able to get up to 90 miles an hour. This is, again, the Thomas Viaduct. The Baltimore and Ohio Railroad loves parking their trains on top of the Thomas Viaduct. It's one of their favorite places. If you go in the Baltimore and Ohio Railroad Museum, they just have piles of pictures of this, of trains parked on top of the viaduct. All right. A couple of more railroad images. This is the Berwyn Station, Branchville Station, just a couple miles up the street, basically on either end of 193, either side of 193, both gone. This is another fantastic story, and I wish I had, you know, hours to talk about it because it really is just a phenomenal thing. This is called the Fair of the Iron Horse. In 1927, September 24th, 1927, opened to an attendance of 46,000 people. This comes from their catalog that they produced. It's on Google Books. This is the introduction to the final edition of that catalog. And just their writing just sings. A cloudless autumn day with the warmth of the sun, tempered by a gentle western breeze, made conditions ideal upon the grounds. The exhibition was completely finished at the announced hour of its opening, and the pageant moved upon the day as if it had been rehearsed for months. I mean, who writes like that nowadays? They had anticipated about 20,000 each day, but they were receiving close to 40 to 60. On Saturday, October 1st, 76,000 people passed through the gateways. By Saturday, October 15th, because there was so much interest, they extended it an extra week. They had 110,000 people entered. On the 23 days of its existence, more than 1.2 million people entered. So what this was a fair where they brought in all the historic railroad bits and showed them off. This is up in Halethorpe. This is actually a industrial park. No sign to be found. You can find a road as you're going along Route 1 that's called Halethorpe Farm Road, and that will take you back there, and you'll just end up in this industrial park. But that's where this thing was, and you can see it was this massive complex with these striped roofs, and the trains would come in for these grandstands along here, and everybody would watch these different types of trains and learn about the history. Well, the bulk of that was supposed to become the B&O Railroad Museum at that site. But a massive storm came through and destroyed the buildings. So they picked up all their pieces and they moved them to Baltimore, where it became the Baltimore and Ohio Railroad Museum, which of course was hit by a massive storm and half of the roof collapsed. So it's kind of had that history going on. I need to find out way more about this. There's this Native American collection here. I really want to dig into it much deeper than I have. WB&A, we know about the WB&A Railroad Trail. And the WBNA trail went from Baltimore to Washington with a branch to Annapolis. That was the old Annapolis and Elk Ridge Railroad. And it is right where Fort Meade is. Fort Meade is located where it is because, in large part, not just Route 1 or any of those other things, but in large part because the WBNA. That location was superior for getting troops on and off interurbans coming out of Baltimore. Terminology, very quickly, it still bothers me that we have it called the trolley trail in Hyattsville College Park area, because there are no trolleys south of the Mason-Dixon line. There are streetcars. They're the same thing, but they are streetcars. So just know that, it shouldn't be the trolley trail, it should be the streetcar trail, but there we have it. So the interurbans were different because they intentionally went much longer distances between major urban areas, interurban. They weren't trolleys that were mostly in that urban area, so they would travel these much longer distances. They basically looked the same, they ran on overhead wires the same, but they were called interurbans. A few more streetcar images. This is Riverdale Park Town Center, not the new place, the old place. And then here's some passing. We haven't completely confirmed where this is. There's some feeling that that's Hyattsville. There's some feeling that that might be closer to Brentwood, that upper image. Here's another image that I love, because you look at it once and it's nothing particularly special. You look at it again, and if you know what you're looking for, there's an entire story going on here, and that entire story revolves around this little puff of dust here. So we've got a gentleman here, he's got a broom. We've got some guys over here in suits. We've got some construction stuff laying around here, and we're trying to figure out what's going on. This is also, you should know, is a PCC car, which is a post-World War, it's a kind of a World War era type of car. So we know that we're looking at that particular time frame. So if we know that we're looking at the trolley line, the streetcar line that ran all the way out to Laurel, we know by this point it's already been cut back to Beltsville. So we know that it's not quite there. So what we're looking at is, again, it's being cut back again from Beltsville back to Branchville. Branchville is where 193 and the road splits there. There's a 7-Eleven there, if you will. And what they're creating at this location is a loop. These guys are from the company. This is an employee who's been building this thing. And what this is the turning loop. And this guy hanging out the back is important, because what he's holding is he's holding down the pickup, the thing that's going to touch the wire. Okay? And he's holding down that pickup, and they've told the driver, goose it, go as fast as you can, because he has no power. But the guys from the company have showed up that day, and they want to see a test of this thing, so they know that their trolley isn't going to fall off the tracks. So they've sped up as fast as they can to get around this Branchville loop before running out of power, and they're going to come circling back. This is the old trolley line here. You can still see the wires up ahead, and they haven't installed the other wires there. So just that little puff of dust shows us that they've goosed it really hard, and the guy took the picture just as they come into that loop. So it's really fascinating. I was at the trolley museum giving a conversation, and I said, "Yeah, here's an interesting picture." And those trolley guys, they picked this thing apart like crazy. They had all kinds of fun with that one. Great sign near Elk Ridge. I'm just giving you a sense, 30 miles to Washington, 10 miles to Baltimore. So we're talking about a 40-mile span here, roughly. But what this also does is this gives us a point where you can head on 10 miles to the National Pike. Most people, when they hear about historic roads, they're hearing about Route 40, the National Road. And Route 40 has a couple of museums around it. Route 1 does not. So if anybody would like to help me start a Route 1 museum, I'd like to get that going. A couple other images. This image of Bladensburg, we are conspicuously missing the Peace Cross, but we have a trolley line, a streetcar line running here. Well, that's the remains of the Greta Spa Spring and Berwyn trolley line, streetcar line, that is was actually battery operated. So they charge up the battery in DC, they'd send the streetcar on its way, it would make it to Bladensburg, no problem, it would pick up some people, it would then turn, and it used roughly Kenilworth Avenue. Well, if you know Kenilworth Avenue, there's a pretty sharp hill just as you come into Berwyn Heights. It's coming up that hill, you're at the end of that battery's life. So there are multiple stories about how people had to get off of the car and get behind and push it up the hill in order to get to their final stop. That didn't last terribly long. The company lost a lot of money, but they tried to use a battery operated rather than overhead. But you do see these overhead wires. So this was at the point where they just had transitioned off of that battery powered into the overhead wires. But again, they were just hemorrhaging money. The streetcars and trolleys were one of the early dot-com bubbles. Everybody invested in streetcars and trolleys and lost acres of money. So here is that same streetcar line over here. And here, this bridge is the same bridge as we see here. This is a little bit later, and what they're doing is they're building the crossing of the Anacostia River. This is an image that was sent to me by State Highways out of their collection after I finished the book. And here it is being reconstructed again and widened out. Our Peace Cross has finally shown up here. This is in 1931, so it's about 10 years old. And what I just love about this image is that instead of having, you know, cones and signs for 3 miles and traffic, nope, we have go slow, men working. That's just don't get hurt, you know, go ahead. This is the final version of that much wider bridge. Then you were still looking in towards Peace Cross, is kind of right there. The bridge has now been shifted and is now the modern bridge. That bridge no longer exists. All right. Continuing on, we're very much in the automobile age. This is Dead Man's Curve up near Elk Ridge. And I always like Dead Man's Curve. We know approximately the date of this image because we know the date whenever the road was changed. So these are from around 1920, about a mile south of Elk Ridge, with nearly 50 deaths and hundreds of accidents. They eliminated the curve in 1917. The embankment originally was over here, and it kind of came through that way, so it was a much tighter curve. The new alignment, still curved, but opened up the view, stemming the death toll. Yet, during the Prohibition, rum runners still found the curves tricky, as reported in a 1924 Baltimore Sun article about a driver who had skidded at the curve and plunged over the 20-foot embankment. Now, this one over here I like as well because this has just happened when this image is taken. Because you can see the car has skid marks, has come to a stop. There's a guy inside here with his hat on. The woman and the child are peering into the car. We don't know what has happened, but I do like this report from Public Roads from 1921, where the Maryland State Roads Commissioner said, "The outstanding fact is that the clear majority of the disasters that overtake motorists are brought upon themselves by their own recklessness, and 90% are due to just one cause, speeding." So it was at this point that they were starting to widen the shoulders to create a better place for these cars to pull off and not end over in the ditches. You can also see in this image, the bases of these telephone poles are painted white as a reflective element so that you don't crash into a telephone pole at night. You got to remember, of course, we're dealing with headlamps that are way dimmer than anything we've got today. I throw this image in. This is actually an image showing a turnpike being built in Boonesboro. But the reason I bring it is because I do talk for a few moments in the book about construction methodologies. And I didn't have this image at the time, and I wish I had. This shows the McAdam method. We may know today, we've heard the term McAdam or Macadam, different ways people have said it. Well, there was an actual process, and this Scottish guy said there were two major elements to making sure that a road was constructed properly. One of them was creating ditches and ways that the water would drain away from the road. And that's not terribly different from today. We want to make sure the water is draining away from our roads. It keeps them keeps the construction or the management costs down. But the other thing he said, and he said this was the most vitally important, was that in order to construct it, they would take these stones of about, you know, 8 inches square roughly, and a person would have to sit. That was the important part. They had to sit down in the road and hammer them until they broke them into the pieces that would fit together. He said that was the most important part, was sitting on the road and doing it right there. They couldn't do it on their own. They had to sit there right over top of it. So this was a Scottish guy named McAdam, and he invented this methodology, which was used for a very long time. This is... We don't have many examples of those roads. That Boonesboro Turnpike is one of the few examples of a true McAdam road. Anybody know where this is? There's our building in the back. That's Rossboro Inn, off in the distance there. This is from about 1915. Do we know what time of year?
October.
Are those oyster shells?
October, oyster shells. You're the first one to ever say oyster shells.
It's definitely fall.
It's definitely fall. The reason we know it's fall is because the corn is very high right here off of the University of Maryland. And the other reason that we know it is because of those oyster shells right here, these stacks. They would put out stone and oyster shells in the fall because the road would get severely damaged over the winter, become severely rutted, but that way in the spring they could come back and spread it right back out. They didn't have to bring it out in the spring whenever it was all frozen stiff. They knew that it would be sitting out there waiting for them, ready to spread. And another part of this picture that I really liked was cars, horses, people, all on one roadway. It was a shared roadway, didn't have sidewalks or anything else. Good luck doing that today. This is, again, more modern construction. Here's our cement construction. Right here as we're building a bridge. This is just about where Charles Armantrout is in Hyattsville. Flooding, of course, was a common occurrence on both the Anacostia and the Patuxent Rivers, or Patapsco Rivers. This is right after one of the hurricanes. This was just on a normal day in Hyattsville after a big rain. That's why, of course, we have the levee system that we have today in that area is to do that. I had a woman come up to me afterwards. She said, I lived in Bladensburg as a child, and we'd always take out our Sunday bath tubs, and we'd float around in the water. So it was a pretty common occurrence right through there. Here's our Peace Cross, which we know is in a bit of a limbo these days. I won't get into that. But the Memorial Cross, as it was labeled whenever it was started, Memorial Cross in the 1920s under the American Legion, was always on this piece of land that was where the highways came together. There wasn't necessarily this whole big circular piece. That happened after other parts of it. That's my warning. There were, the pieces sort of have gotten chipped away. Here's Laurel. So one of the other things I did during my life is I had a 3-month stint as the executive director of the American Diner Museum. I called up my diner friends and I said, I've got this great picture of Laurel. Here's their little tavern, but there's this diner and I don't know what that diner is. Can somebody help me out? Well, that is a 1934 Silk City diner. Just like we'd buy a Ford or a Chevy, you could buy a Silk City or a Fodero or a different type of diner companies. Well, the modern Laurel Diner is a Comac, and there's only about 3 of them left in existence. If anybody has any interest in Laurel, they're fighting to save it right now, the modern 1950s version. But this 1934, we're not sure what happened to it. It is of a very unique design because of these side doors. Typically, they were end doors, so it's a pretty unique structure. I really wish I knew what happened to it. Here's our modern Laurel Diner. Again, that's the one that's under development to be turned into a marijuana dispensary. This is Main Street looking west down Laurel. We're hoping that perhaps this group can come together and move it down the street a little bit. Here's another shot of Laurel looking north. Laurel Hotel. I love this image because it's got the pie truck. We need more pie trucks nowadays. Here's the image from the front of the book. Whenever you're doing this process, they ask you to send them several pictures that can be used for the cover. So I sent them several, and they went, we don't like them. It was that one from College Park I really liked. They finally said, we like this one. I said, what do you like about that? I don't understand. They said, well, cars movement. I said, okay, well, the problem is I don't know where it is. I said, how can I tell people this wonderful cover and not know where it is? Well, since then, we figured it out. This structure here still exists. If you are on US 1 and you have just passed Savage and you cross under Maryland 32, Maryland 32 would be directly above us right now. And so this piece still exists. If you drive through there today, you'll see this building with 5 windows across it. The signs in the background, the Wilkin Family Whiskey, the American Beer, and then Emerson's Hotel. Now, Emerson's Hotel was owned by Captain Emerson. Captain Emerson started the Emerson Hotel. He also had involvement with American Beer. But Captain Emerson started his hotel because he was eating dinner at a restaurant in a hotel in the city. and it was hot. It was the middle of the summer. So he took his jacket off. The maitre d' ran over to him, said, "No, sir, you're not allowed to take off your jacket in here. You must wear a jacket." He said, and he was a pretty fire guy, "Well, that be damned. I'm going to start my own hotel where anybody can take off their jacket." So he started his own hotel just to spite the other hotel so that he could take off his jacket in the dining room. Captain Emerson's a good guy to read. He's the Broma Seltzer guy. He's the one that developed Broma Seltzer.
Is that last picture looking north?
That's looking northbound, correct. All right, so here's the Berwyn Diner. Now, this is labeled in the Library of Congress as the Berwyn Diner. The folks that are from Berwyn have a walking tour of the Berwyn neighborhood with this on the cover. The folks from College Park said, "Oh, yes, the folks in Berwyn remember this very vividly. They loved going to this diner." I said, "Okay, well, we'll make sure we include this picture." Anybody know what this logo is? Ballantine Beer. That's Ballantine Beer. Well, remember Ballantine Beer. We'll come back to them. 25-cent platter, 5-cent hot dogs. In the original image on the Library of Congress, there's a very disturbed young lady who's kind of trying to figure out why this guy's taking a picture of their hot dog stand. Can't really understand it. Diner, beer served in frosted mugs, et cetera, et cetera. It's a really neat kind of looking building. We've got an arrow back here, dining room, Maxwell Diner, et cetera. So I moved on. I was going to try to figure this out.
Are those stools on the outside?
Those are stools on the outside, correct. Mm-hmm. So you could pull right in off of the highway, get your lunch, and get back in your car and get right out of there.
Fast food.
Fast food, absolutely. So I was continuing to do my research. This is Elk Ridge. Here in the distance is the building that's now the new Guinness factory building. This is Daniel's Bar. Some people know it as the Biker Bar over on this side. But then something caught my attention on that side. That Maxwell Diner and that arrow look like those could be the same. So I called, I'm not sure, this seems weird. I called back up College Park, I said, "You're sure it's in Berwyn?" "Oh yes, they loved it there. People talk about it all the time." "You're sure?" They said, "Yeah, absolutely." I said, "Okay, I think they're wrong." But there was no covered bit right here. So I thought, well, maybe they were just happened to be the same names. Maybe they were owned by the same guy. I don't know. And then I found the evidence. There's that covered bit. You can still see the 25-cent platter. There's the Ballantine beer, Maxwell Diner. I said, "Guys, it was never in College Park. It was never in Berwyn." I said, "I've contacted the Library of Congress to let them know it's labeled incorrectly." I said, "It was the guy who did the picture back from the Farm Security Administration photos did it incorrectly." And they said, so now they're off in search of some other picture of the Berwyn neighborhood that they can use. This is actually in Elkridge.
Oh, Elkridge.
Elkridge, yep.
Way off.
Yeah, exactly. Okay, College Park. Here we've got the student-owned and operated Sinclair Station. This is, again, just talking about Berwyn. Berwyn Road is right up here at the top of this little hill there. You can see this little crenellated gas station here, frozen custard. Jump forward a few years. Anybody know where we are here? This is what gives it away. This is a glass repair operation. This is Town Hall. Not Town Hall, but Town Hall, where you can get your liquor to go or in. All the new construction has happened on this side. Here we are. What caught my attention, though, was off in the distance, there's a word diner. So I got to find out more about that diner in a moment. Liquors, cabins, let's jump forward. Here is the remains of the number one Liquors, which was recently changed to the Vigilante. It was sandwiched between the two student housing developments in College Park. It's now a Vigilante. They've substituted one brew for another. There's our Holiday Inn sign. Aha, there's my diner. What's he looking at? So there he is, right next to the Falcon. Norman Falcon Motors is our diner. It looks like it says Park College Diner. And there's our Park College Diner. I've since found out that it still exists. It got moved north of Baltimore and is sitting in some guy's field. So if somebody wants a diner, we can get the Park College Diner back here. Open 24 hours, steaks and chops, club breakfast. I don't know what a club breakfast is, but I want one.
I saw a picture in there that said Varsity Grill. It didn't say College Park, I don't think.
Oh, in here?
In the book.
I'll have to take a look. Yeah, we can take a look. Stewart's Brick Cottages, Grandview Inn. Route 1 through this particular area was not an area that had a lot of roadside, like funky things, you know, elephants and that sort of stuff. We had more food and gas lodging types of places. Here's the Delhaven White House Cottages and Tip Top Motor Court. I tried to be funny and show the Tip Top Motor Court in a presentation to at Elkridge, and I said, has anybody stayed in the no-tell motel? And the guy went, my dad built that. And I went, okay, never mind, moving on. Delhaven was where the IKEA is now, right there in that location. And I had a gentleman, I was doing a presentation to a roadside group, and he came up and he said, I work in Beltsville. I said, oh, that's very cool. You know, he goes, no, what's really cool is like I used to be a neon restorer, and I was driving by when they were tearing down the Delhaven White House, and there laying on the side of the road, fallen out of the dumpster, was part of the sign. He said, do you want it? I said, of course I want it. He said, do you want the neon restored? Of course I want the neon restored. So in our Heritage Center, this Thursday, I'm hoping that he's going to be delivering me a 4-foot round piece that says White House on it with the neon restored. All those pieces are coming together. I'm really hoping that we get that piece up and in and plugged in. He's got it rebuilt. It's got a new power. Does anybody remember the one spot? The one spot was located right where 175 and Route 1 occurred. I mentioned we didn't have a lot of these kinds of places on Route 1, but the one spot was one of those big places that we had. One spot kills lice, ants, bedbugs, bean beetles, and any other pests. I'm sure it killed a lot more than that. This is the giant dog here. I've been told that it was outlined in neon, and this was actually their factory. This is where they made that flea killer. And the only structure that still remains is this little peaked with a big flat dormers to it. That's the only building that still exists. It's right next to a motel, whatever they are, Motel 8 or whatever, Motel 7 or one of those kinds of places. This is on the west side, looking northbound, and 175 is just over that little rise that you see there. You've only got south, maybe not even a mile. Of course, Route 1 was not necessarily welcome to everyone. The experience of an African-American traveler on US 1 was very different than that of a white traveler. We are still in an era of Jim Crow laws. So it was a segregated type of place. This is an image actually from north of Baltimore. This didn't exist on our part. What we do know is that these structures here, these cabins, are from our particular area in this region. There are no listing. I don't know if you have, a lot more people are aware of the Green Book than when I started actually writing this thing not even a year ago. The Green Book, now there's a movie coming out about it. Was it? Yeah, so the Green Book was a book that African-American travelers would use to locate places that they knew that they would be welcome into. And there are no listings for US 1, which is very interesting. So there's a group of us, Ann Bruder from State Highways and a couple other people, were trying to figure out why aren't these listed, where are they? We know that they're there. In fact, in National History Museum is a African-American-owned cottage court structure. It's in the Hall of Transportation, and it's from Muirkirk. So we have a Prince George's piece right there in the National History Museum. But there's just not a lot of information about African-American-owned places along US 1, so we want to dig more into that. So as we're wrapping up, as we're getting close to our modern times, we have the creation of the Harbor Tunnel, which is now the 895 portion there around Elkridge. We have the BW Parkway get open. Traffic is already bad at the day that it opens. We have our traffic cops out. The traffic cops are out there taking pictures with their traffic camera, literally a camera to take a picture of. This is an image of College Park. Anybody know where we are?
Yes.
Where are we?
It's most recently, the Quality Inn or whatever.
And then next to it is...
And they're tearing it down, and you can see that zigzag.
You can see the zigzag, because as the pieces fall down. Yep, this zigzag is still there. It was hit. It's right next to where Plato's was. Plato's was the Howard Johnson's, right here. And then this, you can still see that roof outline. And these zigzags, yes, are hidden underneath there. The part of the building started to fall away, and you can still see those zigzags. They built right over top of that. Sydney Lust Drive-In in Beltsville, which is now the Costco in Beltsville. Sidney Lust, this is the point at which we were showing X-rated films. That's usually the way drive-in movie theaters went. They went from reputable to very unreputable. But Sidney Lust owned a huge chain of movie theaters in the region, including what is now the Public Playhouse. Railroads are coming towards their decline. Now they're mostly freight railroads. They've lost their passenger service. This is the BW Parkway being built over top of that. Last day of streetcars in D.C. was 1968. It ended for us about 8 years earlier, 9 years earlier in this region. This is the opening of the Capitol Beltway. You can see traffic's already bad, waiting for the things to clear. This is in Hyattsville, Lustine Motors, Hyattsville Auto Sales. So basically where the new developments have all occurred in Hyattsville. And I like ending on this particular image. This comes out of the Historic American Building Survey. They did a survey related to the Baltimore-Washington Parkway. It's accessible on the Library of Congress. I encourage you to go take a look through it. They're really great sheets. And what they did was they showed the evolving roadway types, three different types, US 1 with at-grade crossings, roadside development, cuts, unlimited access, versus the wider Baltimore-Washington Parkway, the development of these medians, but again, still slower speed, but interchanges, limited access, and then followed up with 95 with these very large 84-foot wide rights-of-way with a median in the center, very large cloverleaf interchanges, and of course the modern roadside development. And if I can encourage you to just do one thing when you're out there, and this kind of crowd might be the crowd that does it already, but you know, get off those highways when you can, get off those interstates, get onto places like Route 1. Those places are disappearing very quickly. We're losing our local type of influenced roadside architecture. You know, try to spot it when you can. And as you're, you know, maybe working through projects where you might come across these types of things, let's make sure we're documenting them, make sure we're getting the information out there, because we can find, I love a Cracker Barrel as much as the next guy, but they're all the same. We know that they're all the same. We know that our chicken and dumplings are going to be exactly the same no matter where we go. But if I go to that local diner, that Laurel Diner, the food, who knows what you're going to come up with. So I encourage you to get out on these places and get on them. And we don't know what's happening next. I have had conversations about perhaps continuing this story north of Baltimore and south of Baltimore or south of D.C. So we'll see where those go as well. There is no one single book about the history of U.S. 1. There's lots of little bits, but no single history. So we'd like to see if that can happen. So the books are 20. Happy to sign them. Can take cash or charge. If anybody has questions, you can hit my email there, Aaron@AnacostiaTrails, whether it's about U.S. 1 history or whether it's about the work that we do. If you're interested in the grant programs that we've got through Anacostia Trails, you can always connect with me. Or if you're just working on a project in northern Prince George's County, I know a lot of you are park and planning folks, so if you're working on a project in northern Prince George's County, happy to try to involve myself if you need the help. Okay? Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you. We do have the room for a bit longer, so if there are, unless you
anybody
call,
yeah, of course.
Are there any questions for Aaron?
Any
about
questions?
Either part of his presentation.
Yeah.
Something I missed a little earlier. Did you say you were trying to? You were using one name, and somebody said it's already taken. So you had to.
Yeah. So we've been using the Maryland Milestones name as our branding, just because we knew we had to at least tell people we were in Maryland. Anacostia is too related to D.C. in many ways. So we said we're going to use the Maryland. The Milestones thing was us just trying to play around with the alliteration. But what, we realized is that milestones are markers along highways and trains and trolleys, but they're also the firsts and uniques that we've got for the region. So let's use that kind of concept. So we're still technically Anacostia Trails Heritage Area. That is our legal name. That is who we are as an organization. But the Maryland Milestones is the branding, if you will. So whenever like our heritage tours, that's where you'll see the Maryland Milestones more often.
I see.
Any other questions? Yeah.
Okay, you mentioned that you could connect the Route 1 to the Native American heritage. So I wanted to ask you, Jennifer, would you be able to research that based on archaeology?
I defer to experts.
artifacts, you know, that might be...
I think the short term was is there's not much.
Not much.
Two.
Not much undisturbed.
Yeah, I mean, there have been a lot of Native American artifacts found along the Anacostia.
Right.
It is kind of hard because it's very developed. Now, I have found, like Croon Road, I have found in old deed records, they mentioned that was an old Indian trail.
Oh, interesting.
But I haven't really gone through many of the deed records in that area to see if there's any reference to,
And we do know that the road shifted over time here and there. It hasn't changed dramatically since the 1790s, but to me, there's enough there that makes me go, ooh, there's probably something, but just not everything's changed. So much has changed on that particular stretch. If we can find something, I would love to dig at it, but it's not there yet.
Aaron, yeah. You mentioned the funding that you get for your organization is from the state and from the dues.
Yep.
Does the business community contribute directly to you, or is it just the fundraising option that they have?
Good question. We've been doing it as fundraising. And, you know, the problem with heritage areas is that a group like this probably understands a heritage area much more quickly than the average layperson. Heritage areas are hard things to describe. You can kind of go, here's a museum, and people get it. But when you say, oh, we're kind of doing this, like, large landscape concert, just zone out. But what we have found is that we've had some luck with developers because we can hook them on the quality of life thing, that we're kind of trying to work across a large span to create a quality of life built around history, art, and culture. They're like, oh, we kind of get that. So, you know, Riverdale Park Station, we've had some good conversations with, that sort of thing. But we haven't had to do a huge amount of fundraising beyond the funds that we get from the communities and from the county and such. But that will change if we go to the southern part of the county, because they don't have towns the way we do in the northern part of the county. So how we address that is a big part of that question. And the board has been talking more about fundraising. We just recently had somebody who is involved in some development and such land us about $15,000. So that's been the first time that we've ever really had to do that in a significant way. But I look forward to doing more of it if we can. Yeah. Anyone else?
Yeah. Hey, Aaron. I just want to let you know, Riverdale Passenger, remember they put an airplane? Is that a real airplane?
Riverdale Park Station, yes.
Yeah, but they're going to put another streetcar they bought from Boston.
I've recently heard this.
They're going to put it in. Right?
They're going to put in this in a streetcar.
Yeah.
Sounds great to me. That's the one thing about that development. You know, I know that there were a million different views on that particular development, and I take no opinion whatsoever. But I can walk from Route 1 past an air coop to the trolley trail, maybe with a streetcar on it, to the train, and I can tell the entire span of transportation history on one property, basically. So from my standpoint, and plus we've got the McAlpin ice well. So it's a great story all in one place, but that's interesting to hear.
Yeah.
Yeah, thank you.
Like that bridge to nowhere.
Well, the bridge now is somewhere. I use that as my shortcut all the time.
Are your events in a calendar format on your website?
Yes, we have the events on our calendar, on the website, and then we do a weekly e-blast with everything that's going on that weekend.
Okay. Touching on your expertise in the diners, do you have a great example of a classic streetcar diner that's still in use?
Okay, so for one thing, I'll say this: there are very few examples. So we often get questions from people. Like, oh, that must have been an old train car. We don't have very few. Well, there's not many that were trains that became diners.
Right.
There are a few, very few, that were streetcars that became diners. Not terribly common, but a few.
Bethesda used to have.
My favorite is the one over on 29, actually.
Okay.
In Virginia.
Virginia.
That's a really great one. I think they call it the 29 Diner.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
Man, they had some good pancakes.
Right.
on our corridor, Laurel is it. There used to be Frank's Diner, which was actually a built-in place tilt-up, but that's gone out of business.
I was recently at the Exmoor Diner on 13.
Okay.
On the Virginia's Eastern
Shore. Yeah, Street. Yeah.
It's beautiful.
Yeah, and there are definitely, I mean, if you're going for diners, I always encourage folks to go to Rhode Island. Mm-hmm. Rhode Island is sort of a birthplace of diners, and there's some really great ones up there. Mm-hmm. And of course, New Jersey has a great collection, so. You always buy the club sandwich. Everybody knows that, right?
Oh, really?
You buy the club sandwich. That's how you can tell the differences between them. If they make a good club sandwich, the rest of their food is going to be good.
Good to know.
All right. I think that's probably us.
All right. Thank you very much, Eric.